Chaitanya Prabhu Daya Kora More Sri Krishna. Is it there? Okay. Yeah. Can you all see that? You have to get closer. Actually, the seats are the same price anywhere you sit. Come closer. So this is actually in one temple in Slovenia, and actually the main temple there, they sing this every day as part of the morning program. It's a beautiful song. It's really the reason why they do that is because they have Panchatattva deities. So this is really a deep song by Srila Narottam Das Thakur, glorifying the Lord and the Vaishnavas. Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Daya Gora More Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Daya Gaura Mohore Dhamma Bhina Kedhayalu Jagga Samsahare Patita Pavanha Etu Dhavavatara Samabhantita Prabhu Nappayi Behara Nappayi Behara Prabhu Nitya Nanda Prema Nanda Sukhi Prema Nanda Sukhi Kripa Bolo Khanha Khoro Ami Bhadu Ki Kora ham hibhara dhuki Hehe dhoya kora siddha pati Advaita gosaham Tava kripa bole Vahai Chaitanya Nita Hai Chaitanya Nita Ha Swarup Sanna Tanna Rupa Raguna Taham Rupa Raguna Bhatta Yoga Siji Vaha Prabhu Lokanata. Prabhu Lokanata. Dhoya Korosiya Jaya Prabhu Srinivasa. Amha Chanda Sangha Bhagyehe Narottam Dhaka. Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Dhoya Gaura Mohare Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Dhoya Gaura Mohare Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama Hare Rama Rama Hare 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 Krishna Krishna Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Jaya Gauranidhar 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 Jaya Gauranidhar Gauranidhar Jaya Panchatattva 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 Jaya Panchatattva Hare 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 Hare
Gauranga, hey Gauranga, hey Jai Hare 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 Hare
Shri Krishna Chaitanya Doya Kora More. Sorry to wake you up. Did I wake you up? Sorry. It's good to get woken up, right? Udilo arana gaurana bhaji dvijamani gaura amhani jage tatari tatari bhajiro rom gana gana jirma jiro ro. Then the last part of jeev jago hum gaura chandra bhole kota nidra Jayo Maya Hum Pisa Chira Kole. When I first joined the Hare Krishna movement, that was a song we would sing every morning as part of the morning program. It's called the morning song, actually. And it's Lord Chaitanya. And it's describing him. He's going through the town of Nadia early in the morning with his kirtan team and saying, "Wake up! Wake up! You're sleeping! You're simply interested in decorating your dead bodies. That's all you do." And then he goes on to say, Bhaktivinoda, of course, sings this song, and he says, "You're sleeping, but where are you sleeping? On Maya, who's a witch. She's sucking out your blood, and you like it." So we have to wake up to Krishna. Wake up. It's a waking call. They say if you snooze, you lose. Don't sleep. You can, don't forget to eat, but you can forget to sleep. They say all great persons, if you study their life, you found out they slept very little. Sleeping is a kind of intoxication that is, when you're not happy, you just sleep. Void out, right? But when you're happy, you think, "Man, why should I go to sleep? This is enjoyable." So it's kind of an intoxication, sleep. It's a form of death, actually. When you're sleeping, you're dead. You're breathing, but it's like a subtle form of death. So, Prabhupada, in 1974, he dropped a bomb on the whole society, really a big bomb. He said, out of the four activities of the body, eating, sleeping, mating, and defending, the worst one is oversleeping. Then he explained a little. He said, because that increases the others, eating and mating like that. So Prabhupada said, sleep, what, six hours the most, right? Like that. And if you need a little more, you can sleep 6 hours and 5 minutes. But sleeping is really, I mean, there's gun and gone. Where's the Bengalis here? No Bengalis. Gun and gone. One is perspiration and the other one is sleep. So perspiration means those who work hard, you know, that's good. But those who like don't work hard, they just want to sleep all the time. Oh, it's so nice. Mother Nidra, you're my favorite worshipful deity. I do puja to you every day. And in fact, it's my favorite deity. Om Namo Sleep. So we should try to reduce sleep. And Prabhupada was in New Vrindavan, he said, you have such a nice atmosphere here. You should sleep 1 hour a night. Because when the atmosphere is nice, it's easier not to be affected by the lower modes, right? Prabhupada was in the 70s. And he would take rest at between 10:30 and 11 every night, get up at 12. So he slept for about an hour and a half the most. And that wasn't even a full sleep. And then he would begin his dictating for a few hours, and then he would chant japa. Then when it became early morning, he would take his morning walk, and then he would arrive at the temple, sit down in the Vyasasana, accept Guru Puja, and then give class. And then he would go for breakfast. And after breakfast, he'd take sometimes an hour rest. And then he would get his massage for about an hour and a half. And then he'd answer letters and he'd preach to the devotees. That led all the way up to lunch. And then lunch, he would have his lunch. And then after lunch, he slept another hour. And then after that, he did various things, usually preaching, traveling, or whatever he had to do. And that was his schedule. So he slept an hour and a half at night the most, an hour during the day after lunch, an hour. Try that schedule. Don't try it. You won't be able to do it. That was Prabhupada. He was in his 70s. In fact, he was doing it all the way till the end. At one point, he was not sleeping at all. At the very end, he just stopped eating and stopped sleeping. He said, no more eating, no more sleeping. There's no question of sex life, defense. I'm liberated. He was joking, you know. So the more we reduce the bodily activities, the more we can taste the sweetness of Krishna consciousness. If we're sleeping too much, or if we're eating too much, or if we're, you know, the devotees don't get involved in sex life, right? But defending is another form of material consciousness, always trying to protect eating and sleeping and mating. And so these are the animal propensities, and they're there in the human form, but they're meant to be reduced. Not artificially, but naturally. But there's a conscious effort to keep the natural flow always going. Devotee thinks, oh, why should I have to sleep? I gotta waste time now. I could be serving Krishna. Okay, so Srimad Bhagavatam, 6th canto, chapter 7. This is verse number 15. Indra offends Brihaspati. We'll continue with our series on guru-disciple relationship. So this is an interesting verse. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Ataham Amaracharyam Agadadishanam Dvijam Prasadayashe Nistata Shrishna Tach Charanam Sprinsan Ataham Amararcharyam Agada Dishanam Dvija Prasada Yishye Nishtata Shrishna Tach Charanam Sprishan. Chant. Ladies. Therefore, aham, I, Amara Archayam, the spiritual master of the demigods, Agada Nishdishanam, with spiritual knowledge in deep, Dvija, the perfect Brahmana, Prasada Yishye, I shall please. Nishata, without duplicity. Shirshna, with my head. Tat, charanam, his lotus feet. Sprishan, touching. So King Indra, he's speaking now, and he's speaking about Brihaspati. King Indra said, therefore, with great frankness and without duplicity, I shall now bow my head at the lotus feet of Brihaspati, the spiritual master of the demigods, because he is in the mode of goodness. He is fully aware of all knowledge and is the best of the brahmanas. Now I shall touch his lotus feet and offer obeisances unto him to try to satisfy him. Purport. Coming to his senses, King Indra realized that he was not a very sincere disciple of his spiritual master, Brihaspati. Therefore, he decided that henceforth he would be Nishita, non-duplicious. Nishita Shirshna Tach Charanam Sprisam. He decided to touch his head to the feet of his spiritual master. From this example, we should learn this principle enunciated by Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur. Yasya prasada bhagavat prasado yasya prasadan naguti kutopi. By the mercy of the spiritual master, one is benedicted with the mercy of Krishna. Without the grace of the spiritual master, one cannot make any advancement. A disciple should never be a hypocrite or be unfaithful to his spiritual master. In Srimad Bhagavatam 11.17.27, the spiritual master is also called Acharya. Acharyam mam vijaniyan. The Supreme Personality of Godhead says that one should respect the spiritual master, accepting him as the Lord himself. Excuse me. Nava manyete karhi chit. One should not disrespect the Acharya at any time. Namartya buddhya shushyeta. One should never think the Acharya an ordinary person. Familiarity sometimes breeds contempt, but one should be careful in one's dealings with the Acharya. Agada dishanam dvijam. The Acharya is a perfect Brahmana and has unlimited intelligence in guiding the activities of his disciples. Therefore, Krishna advises in Gita 434, Tadbiri pratipatena paripasyena sevaya upadeksyanti te jnanam jnanina tattva darshanah. Just try to learn the truth by approaching a spiritual master, inquire from him submissively, and render service unto him. The self-realized soul can impart knowledge because he has seen the truth. One should fully surrender unto the spiritual master, and with service, sevaya, one should approach him for further spiritual enlightenment. Om agyan timirandasya gyanajana salakaya chaksu unmilitam yena tasmai shri gurave namaha. Shri Chaitanya manovistam stapitam yena bhutale swayam rupa kadam mayam dadati swam padatikam. Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Sivasati Gaur Bhaktivrindam. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So, this is an interesting response to a very calamitous event. What happened was, Indra was being worshipped by all the devas, all the siddhas, the charanas, the kimputrushas, all the heavenly realms had come to give Indra special honor. He was sitting on a very luxurious throne along with his wife Shachi Devi beside him. A beautiful umbrella was held over his head. He was being fanned by his devotees and they were singing his glories. In the midst of all this, while it was going on, Brihaspati, the demigod, spiritual master of Indra and of the demigods, just happened to walk in. Indra saw his spiritual master but didn't do anything. He continued with the worship, and Brihaspati noticed his deviant mentality, didn't say anything, turned around and left. As soon as that happened, Indra came to his senses. Oh, Brihaspati came and I didn't even honor or welcome him. I'm so much engrossed in my own glorification. I didn't properly respect and honor my spiritual master. And so he became repentant. And he realized he committed a grave offense. So now he's responding to that offense by this verse here. He's going to make an effort to somehow or other, he says, with great frankness and without duplicity, I should offer my head to his lotus feet. And aware that he is the best of all brahmanas, I should touch his feet and try to satisfy him. But the problem was, Brihaspati disappeared and no one could find him, including Indra. He became invisible. So there was a great anxiety within the heavenly realm. And this led to demigods losing all their potency. And the demons took advantage of that and attacked and defeated the demigods quite badly. they ran to Brahma for help. But here we see that it was an offense by neglect. It says that one may be very qualified, and one can develop great qualities, and maybe one even has great qualities to start with and becomes even greater when one engages in devotional service. Maybe very expert, maybe even very knowledgeable of Shastra, but in the presence of the spiritual master, one should never present themselves as being anything other but a complete fool. That is the mood of a disciple. Here, because a disciple never tries to present themselves as being advanced or great. And that way, one can always take advantage of the mercy of the spiritual master. So in this verse, there are five elements, maybe you noted them in the purport, which are disqualifications for a disciple. So we should be very careful to avoid one or all of these five. One is duplicitousness. Second is hypocrisy. Third is unfaithfulness. Fourth is disrespect. And the last one is familiarity. As we go through the purport, we'll see all five of these are mentioned in different ways. So what is duplicitousness? Duplicitousness means to present yourself in a way that is not correct. In other words, there's an agenda or a motivation. In other words, I'm serving to get something from my service, or I'm approaching the spiritual master from my own personal, interest. One should always approach the spiritual master for service. That's all. Or to learn, either one. Either to learn or to serve, either one. And if there's some requirement, that will be taken care of through this particular situation. The power of one's devotional service is so strong that simply by service, one solves all their problems. Or gets all their questions answered. We may have a lot of questions, and that's important and for clarification. But we'll find that if we engage in devotional service, by the power of one's service, questions are automatically answered. And I'll give you an example. In the life of Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Maharaj, Prabhupada's spiritual master, one very distinguished, I believe he was a politician, but not the kind of politician we see today who is very avaricious. He was very conscious of spiritual life, had a lot of regard for Bhaktisiddhanta and what he was doing to spread Krishna consciousness. So he came to see Bhaktisiddhanta, paid his obeisances and said, "Maharaj, I have some questions." Bhaktisiddhanta said, "Well, actually, right now, I don't have time for your questions, but why don't you just go to the pujaris and ask them?" So, taking the instructions of Bhaktisiddhanta on his head, he went to the pujaris. And he asked them if he could ask questions. And they said, "Actually, we're taking care of the deities. Silver and brass, we're polishing them now. Why don't you help us with that?" So they had just begun. So he said, "Fine." So he was also polishing the brass along with other the pujaris. And this went on for some time. And after everything was done, he did nice service. They said, "Well, what is your question?" He said, "Thank you. I don't have any questions." And he walked out, and then Bhaktisiddhanta, sorry, I'm leaving, and said, oh, did the pujaris answer your questions? He said, Maharaj, yes, thank you very much, and he left. So what happened was, by his absorption in devotional service, Krishna in the heart revealed the answers to his questions. And not only applies for questions, it applies to problems too. When we are absorbed in Krishna's service, we can also contact Krishna in the form of super soul, and then Krishna will dictate answers, ideas, inspirations. Everything is coming that way. Now, this doesn't mean that we shouldn't ask questions. This is just another way to understand how that most of our questions can be understood, answered through the power of our devotional service. Or we might even say through the power of our chanting of a Hare Krishna Maha Mantra. So a devotee never approaches the Lord, you know, for something material or something, what we say. A devotee wants to hear and learn and also serve. That's all. Sometimes we say, come to learn, learn to serve. Because service is the expression of one's bhakti, like that. So one should not be duplicitous. One has an agenda or a motivation for whatever one does. Hypocrisy. What is hypocrisy? That's a really strong word. It's kind of scary, isn't it? If someone calls you a hypocrite, you're ready to punch him, right? It's a heavy word, really. Prabhupada would use the word rascal. And that's a pretty heavy word in Vedic culture. But for in Western culture, when we talk of rascal, we think of a person who is mischievous, right? Like a little kid who's doing all kinds of naughty things. So, but the word hypocrisy, and it says Kali Yuga is the age of quarrel and hypocrisy. So what is hypocrisy? Means that one is presenting themselves before the spiritual master in such a way as to somehow or other get the favor of the spiritual master, get something from the spiritual master, or in other words, there, you know, it's like I got 25 skeletons in the closet, but I'm presenting myself to you in this way. In other words, not revealing one's heart and mind in order to purify one's existence. You know, in other words, a hypocrite means you present yourself completely different than who you are, like that. I mean, Lord Chaitanya, we mentioned this yesterday, when he went before the Mayavadi sannyasis, he told him, my spiritual master told me I can't study Vedanta. I'm not qualified. He told me, you're a fool. Just chant Hare Krishna. That's all you can do. The scriptures are too difficult for you. Of course, Lord Chaitanya was saying that just to show, you know, the power of the chanting of the Hare Krishna mantra. And he's also acting very humbly in front of these Mayavadis from Yastis who were actually so proud because they had so much scriptural knowledge. Yeah. So a hypocrite, we all know what a hypocrite is. You can start to think in your mind when you think of somebody who's a hypocrite. They say and act one way, but you know it's not them. It's just their show, right? It's just a show. And it's not a show for the sake of the show. It's a show to get something. They're after something, some material gain from that show, like that. So that's considered one of the other disqualifications of a disciple. The third is unfaithfulness. I don't have any faith in the words of my spiritual master, or I have little faith in the words of my spiritual master. Or I have to see if I like the words of my spiritual master before I can actually execute the instructions. That's a kind of unfaithfulness. That should never be there in the life of the disciple, because that principle should have been rectified before one have taken the spiritual master. When one accepts the spiritual master, there's no question of no faith after that. That means one is going backwards. So that means one never had the faith in the first place. You know, we have to be careful of what we call the initial exhilaration of spiritual life, which kind of makes one feel joyful. But then again, when you settle down to the practical reality of the day-to-day life, we have to realize that's the main part of our life, the nitty-gritty, the day-to-day services that we have to do. So one should not somehow or other be enamored by momentary pleasures and think that this is the whole essence of the relationship. Relationship really means to surrender one's life in devotional service. And that is, you know, most of the day we're doing that. That is called our service. So unfaithfulness, disrespect the spiritual master. Now there's different ways to disrespect the spiritual master. If you're in the presence of the spiritual master and you present yourself as being more learned to the spiritual master, if you correct the spiritual master, that's also, if you argue with the spiritual master, these are all forms of disrespect. Even if you're right, you don't argue, because as soon as you argue, you become wrong. That's the relationship, right? Am I wrong about that? Because the spiritual master's more or less trying to teach you something as far as obedience, submission, and humility, which is more important than being right and wrong. You know. But Guru Maharaj, you don't understand me. Yes, I do. That's why you should shut up. Something like that. So the point is, one should be very careful not to, you know, disrespect by acting outside of one's, you know, position. And just like, here's an example. You may be standing next to your spiritual master, and someone will ask a question to your spiritual master, and he seems to hesitate or doesn't know it, and then you answer it. That's another form of disrespect. If he turns to you and says, "Do you know the answer?" you could do that. But if you think, "Well, I'll just give the answer." Or if you're giving a class and your spiritual master walks in, you should automatically get up, welcome him, and ask him to sit down and give the class. That's the etiquette like that. Because to speak in the presence of someone more learned, that is called maryada vatikramita. What is it? Vatikrama. Maryada vatikrama. It's in the third canto. Therefore, an assembly of Vaishnavas, sometimes when we give class, we see elevated Vaishnavas sitting in the class. We say, please give me your blessings to give this class. Please give me your permission to give this class. Like that. So that's done amongst God brothers a lot. We see that. When God brothers are together, if they're there with other senior God brothers, they always acknowledge the other person's presence and sometimes permission to give the talk like that. Because that is a breach of etiquette, to speak in the presence of someone who's more learned. But do we do that when we get the blessings and the permission of the person who's more learned like that? So that's important to understand like that. See, this is what happened to Indra. He was being honored, and his spiritual master walked in. But because he was so enamored by his own honor, he didn't acknowledge the presence of his spiritual master. And then Brihaspati immediately noted it and just turned around and left without saying a word. So disrespect can come in different forms like that. And then the last word is familiarity. Sometimes the spiritual master will be very familiar with the disciple, but the disciple shouldn't respond in the same way. Because if you get familiar, you lose respect. If you get familiar, you lose respect. And then when you lose respect, then you start to minimize the importance of his instructions and his presence like that. So familiarity is there. Prabhupada mentions familiarity sometimes breeds contempt like that. That's why a lot of times spiritual masters don't spend too much time with their disciples, because if they spend too much time with certain disciples, those disciples get familiar and lose respect. So to keep that respect, they keep moving. Depends on the disciples like that. So generally, so these are the five main disqualifications of the fit. We might say unfaithfulness may be, what we say, extended to disobedience. Disobeying the spiritual master's instructions is one of the offenses to the holy name. That's the third offense. But the acharyas discuss this in the more finer aspect, that even minimizing the instructions, oh, this instruction is important and this instruction is not so important. If one thinks like that, then one should get a clarification before they put the instructions into the categories. Because sometimes the spiritual master will give general instructions and it doesn't seem like, he seems like he might be giving you a suggestion rather than an instruction. And if you take it as a suggestion, or you can take it or leave it type thing, you might find yourself in problems. You know, depending on the spiritual master will do that differently with the different disciples. Some disciples, they like to be told what to do. Others don't. But they're somehow trying to accept it anyway. So therefore, the spiritual man. So disobedience, of course, leads to all the other ones. That's the main offense, to disobey the instructions of the spiritual master. That means to disobey the instructions of the Lord, because there's no difference between the instructions. And then there was that one example where we see it sometimes, if we listen to Prabhupada's lectures, we find that Prabhupada sometimes, he will quote a verse and he'll forget the verse, or he'll quote the verse differently than the actual verse. And one senior devotee asked Prabhupada about that. He said, how should we think when we see that? And Prabhupada didn't really respond so much to his question, but the other devotees got on his case for asking that question to Prabhupada. So sometimes we see that the acharya, or the spiritual master, should be perfect in all aspects. But his perfection is not his material abilities, but his ability to engage and elevate the disciple towards devotional service. That's his expertise. It's like we say Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj couldn't even write his name. But still, he was the spiritual master of one of the greatest and of all Vaishnava scholars in the history. And Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati was a walking encyclopedia. He was given that title sometimes. But his spiritual master was Gaur Kishore Das Babaji. And when he met his spiritual master, he would fall flat as a, you know, menial servant, although his spiritual master had no literary ability at all. So that's brought out in the Nectar of Instruction, where some material defect is not a disqualification for a spiritual master. A material defect is not a disqualification. It's just, and it gives you the example is given, just like the Ganges is a very pure water, but sometimes there's dirt and garbage thrown in the Ganges. Does that make the Ganges dirty? No. The Ganges is not dirty because of the pleasance of the garbage, because the Ganges cannot be polluted by anything material. So in the same way, the spiritual master, although may have material defects or material incompetence, that's not a disqualification for his spiritual acumen like that. And sometimes we see that disciples take a spiritual master because they're enchanted or enthralled or attracted by something material about the spiritual master. And that will lead to disappointment later on in the relationship between the disciple and the spiritual master, because the that has a tendency to change or wear off. The reason we take a spiritual master is to a Brahma Jigyasa, to learn what is, you know, the Supreme Brahman or Krishna. That's the only reason. And how to get there through the process of devotional service. So these are dupliciousness, hypocrisy, unfaithfulness, disrespect, familiarity, and of course disobedience. These are the things that should be very carefully avoided in the relationship with the spiritual master. Any questions? Yes, Nityananda Pran.
I'm very grateful to you for doing this seminar.
I'm very grateful to you for suggesting I do it.
And I'm very grateful that you came up with the idea for a seminar. In the beginning of class, Maharaj, you were talking about a disciple should always present himself to the spiritual master as if he were a fool.
But don't act foolish.
Exactly. That's what I was. Otherwise, the guru would have a bunch of foolish disciples and he has to get into every detail of what to do, what not to do. So as a fool would mean, I'm seeking for clarification, would mean I may have an idea or I may think of something as the right thing to do, but when I present it to my spiritual master, what he says has a different connotation perhaps, because he's looking at things from a spiritual point of view that I don't have access to. Is that the mood in which we...
It can be. Yeah, your good material idea may not be either good for your own spiritual life and maybe cause some pride, or just that's not really what he wants you to do, or he may not want you to do it at this time when you suggest it. So you can present it in a humble way. And humble means I'm willing to hear his opinion. Not willing to hear, I'm willing to accept his opinion. And then you go on like that. And if he likes it, wonderful. If, you know, Prabhupada was inspired when devotees come up with intelligent ideas on how to spread Krishna consciousness. So that we don't say you shouldn't use your intelligence, but your intelligence has to be coupled with submissiveness to the authority, like that. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Okay. So another hand in the back. What's your name? Siddhartha. Yes, Hare Krishna.
Maharaj, you said a disciple should not be, the word you used is familiar.
Yeah.
Should not get too familiar with a guru.
Let me read it. In the purport here, it says here, just so you understand what it is. Familiarity breeds contempt, but one should be very careful in one's dealings with the Acharya. That's Prabhupada's statement.
So, we hear there are multiple kinds of gurus. This instruction I can relate to very well if you're talking about someone in your position, someone who is a Diksha Guru. But day to day we interact with so many gurus. It can be a temple president or a mentor, or a temple commander or whoever, and some of them are really very senior to an individual, but they behave with us in a friendly way, and sometimes in our temple the mood is that we also behave with them in a friendly way.
Friendly is one thing, familiar is different. Okay. Friendly, if you can keep your respect, then that's fine. When, as soon as you lose respect, that can be done with familiarity.
Okay, Maharaj.
You know the difference between friendliness and familiarity?
No.
Who can explain what's the difference between familiarity and friendliness? Familiarity is going into areas you're not supposed to be in. And friendliness is just the natural characteristic of a relationship. But in some cases, like Prabhupada said, you shouldn't try to carry on a friendly relationship with the spiritual master. Because the mood is that, you know, he's senior and you're junior and you have to learn. Friendly sometimes takes the stage of equality in relationship. Friends are usually on an equal basis. So then the ability to learn becomes subordinate to the mood of friendship. You follow that?
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, Glenn. Hey, Munchie, you had your hand up? So, you want to go next? It's clear? Okay.
Thank you, Maharaj, for a wonderful class. In our questions, in how service answers our questions, very helpful. And I'm wondering about the issue of inquiry.
Inquiry?
Well, yes, in that, say, questions come up that are on our mind, and we do a service, and we do find the answers. And is the spiritual master wanting to know what our inquiries are, whether or not we get an answer to them, or, you know, does it send a bad message?
Does the spiritual master want to know about our inquiries?
Right.
Is that the question?
Well, I'm thinking our service, in service, answers do come to us. And
yeah.
So should we still...
If you're sure, then go ahead. But if you're not sure, then you can clarify. If there's any doubt, better to clarify than, you know, take a risk and make a mistake.
Will our spiritual master be disappointed or concerned about us if we have, like, too little inquiry?
Well, if you're doing okay, then it's no problem. But if you're not doing okay, you better start inquiring. That's the point. Inquiry should be there when you're, you know, getting a little bit shaky. Otherwise, you can just hear the classes, hear the lectures, and get your, you know, get everything you can from that. And you may discuss, you may ask questions on philosophical principles, but if it comes to practical things, and then there may be a need for that. And the thing is, the thing you should remember is doubts are like demons, and they destroy our ability to practice Krishna consciousness. So as soon as you have doubts, get rid of it, because doubts grow. And they turn into full-blown obstacles. And when they get too full-blown, they actually knock one out of devotional service. So, as Prabhupada said, get your doubts clear up, ask questions. Let's see, Sri Devi, and then after that, Arka, and then after that, Linda. Okay.
Maharaj, I come across this situation very often, so I'm just asking this. When a couple has different spiritual masters,
mm-hmm.
then should the husband's spiritual master be approached and not the wife's, or will that create tension between the couple?
The wife shouldn't act independent of her husband. As soon as she does, she's breaching the whole etiquette. Therefore, she should consult with her husband like that. The husband is actually the spiritual master of the wife. In Vedic culture, that's usually the spiritual master doesn't even deal with women. He deals with the women by dealing with the husband, and the husband deals with the women. But in the case where the woman doesn't have a husband, then there might be have to be some adjustments. So proper, what we say, communications are there in order to help the lady. But if you have a husband, then you just work through your husband, that's all.
But what if the husband is not taking instructions, not really following, and the wife wants to be really following the instructions?
Then she should be, she should act in a way to try to inspire him. She should try to work on helping him become more serious. Not by chastising him, but by inspiring him in a positive way. You know, a relationship between husband and wife, this is a whole seminar in itself. It's not very popular in Western culture, this seminar. But that's why Western culture is so screwed up, because they don't follow the proper culture. They don't want to follow, and yet they have so many problems. So the husband has to be qualified to take care of his wife. Otherwise, he shouldn't take on a wife. And the wife should be qualified to serve her husband. Otherwise, she shouldn't take on a husband. You know, it has to be that relationship. So when there's a question of, you know, your question, then ultimately the husband should decide. You can decide in consultation with each other, but ultimately the spiritual master should deal with the husband like that.
Thank you,
Mark. Mm-hmm. Okay, does that help?
Yes.
Arka? This is a very sensitive point and requires much discussion.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Uh-huh, thank you.
I have a doubt. Over the years, I have heard that once you get initiated, the guru accepts karma of his disciple. And sometimes this state of mind comes that one may not trust himself enough to put his spiritual master at the risk of getting a reaction for future fall downs. And therefore, one may be reluctant to formally accept initiation. And I guess my question is how to handle this state of mind to move forward.
Your concern is appreciated, but it's not really under, it's not real. In the sense that, as I was discussing there with some of my senior god brothers, they say, Krishna doesn't give the spiritual master, you know, enough karma that's going to break him. It's not like, oh, he takes your karma and then he's just going to break, you know. You know, Krishna's going to give that spiritual master some of the karma in such a way that he goes on in his devotional service. So that's not so much a concern. I mean, there's some people we get a little bit scared. I remember there was one person in India, he was an abortionist. And he had performed 35,000 abortions. 35. And then he came to Krishna consciousness. And he was looking for a spiritual master. They were all running in different directions. he was a nice guy. A really nice person. I don't know if he ever got initiated or not. But, you know, that's an extreme case. But in general, I asked this also to one senior god, and he said that Krishna was not going to give you more. He's not going to give you enough. He's not going to break you. Now, what breaks you is if you take on too many disciples, because that's an injunction by Spirit, by Lord Chaitanya. It's written in a purport in the fourth canto. Lord Chaitanya, and Prabhupada explains it, Lord Chaitanya says that one should not accept too many disciples, because that could cause the spiritual master to go down. So what is too many? That's another question. But you know, when you have a good disciple, it gives strength to the spiritual master. And when you have a weak disciple, it pulls away from the spiritual master. So it's the duty of the spiritual master to make this disciple strong, because he also benefits by strong disciples. They also help him in his spiritual life too. Like that. So the best thing you can do for your spiritual master is be serious. Don't break the principles like that, and follow very strictly. Be a sincere disciple. And then the spiritual master can have many disciples if they're all like that. There's no problem. In fact, it's very good.
Thank you, Maharaj.
Okay, so Linda's next. After Linda, a lady behind you. I don't know your name. You're next, yeah.
Thank you very much, Maharaj, for all the classes you've given. I've been learning so much.
Hare Krishna.
I'm just wondering, what is the etiquette, since you talked about the disqualifications of a disciple, if one takes on a Shishka guru?
Shisha.
Shishka? Shishka.
Shiksha.
Shiksha guru. And also senior devotees. What should, you know, you were mentioning these disqualifications, and I'm wondering if they would also apply toward a Shiksha guru or and toward.
Yeah, because guru is equal, both.
And also to senior devotees?
Well, these things are not desirable in any category of activity. You know, disrespect.
Well, I was looking toward familiarity, you know, just how
familiarity
one should...
is like if you have a friend, you may have a relationship, but you can't, you may be very careful not to go deep, too deep in their personal life, because maybe you're bridging that friendship by going too deep, you know. It depends on the friend, you know. I'll give you an example. Prabhupada would speak strongly about those who try to, you know, hear and are interested in Radha Krishna's more intimate pastimes. He says, you know, they're prying into his personal life. And he uses the example, you know, if someone has a wife and somebody comes up and, what's it like with your wife and you? You just punch, you know, you think, this is none of your business, right? That's kind of private, right? So that's what they're doing to Krishna. That's getting familiar. That's bridging the, you know, the limit of friendship, going too far. Okay? So, you know, just be careful. If you're humble, you don't have any problems. Even if you make a little mistake. But if you're not careful and you act, what we say, passionately, without regard or respect for others. So the devotee has respect for everybody. But that's respect is shown in different ways according to the relationship.
Thank you, Maharaj, for the class.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. My question was in regards to, I'm comparing what you said on marriage to something that Bhakti Tirtha Swami said in a seminar.
This was a different time, I said.
Yeah, because he gave the statistic that, you know, it was a seminar on leadership. And so leadership not only in our management in ISKCON, but also in the level of relationships. mm-hmm. you know, who's the leader, anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that came up was in ISKCON, we have a divorce rate that's very high, higher than American society. And so what do we need to do? I mean, to get on track, because we know the philosophy is perfect, but somehow or another, it's not being executed in a way. So I know there must be misunderstandings in application or
something. We lack training. That's the prime. We lack training. We're coming out of a very dysfunctional society, and we're trying to make a relationship out of that without the proper training. So when the training is there, then we know how to function within the relationship like that. But Prabhupada would also say, even if there's some discord or disharmony within the marriage, it's not a cause for divorce. One should try to work it out like that. So it's because of lack of training, we don't know how to play our roles within the relationship. The woman has her role, the man has his role. If each play their roles properly, both benefit individually and within the family. But, you know, the roles sometimes gets upside down. People play the wrong roles, or they don't know exactly how to relate to each other. And part of getting married is choosing a partner that has two things: similar likings, similar nature. Because if you get married with someone who has a different nature, you're starting off on a bad, you know, it's going to be some rough roads. So people get married, why? Because of physical attraction. And that wears off. After 2 to 3 years, they say it wears off. So taste and character. Taste means you like the same things. Character means your natures are just similar like that. And then the third factor is age. There should be a balance of age. The woman should be 5 years younger. Women mature faster than men. That is true. Because of their bodily constitution. You know, like a boy of 16 and a girl of 16 is like a mother, like a woman to a kid. Boys don't grow up so fast. Girls have to grow up because of their nature. That's generally... Is that a protest question? No. I'm favoring the ladies now. But that's true. That is actually true. That's why a woman is younger than the man. Like that. She should be at least 5 years younger, generally. Okay.
His Holiness Bhaktivedya Purna Maharaj.
Oh, he's the expert in this category.
He once said that women, they go from girls to women.
Yeah.
And in the case of males, they go from boys to punks to men. So it takes a little longer.
Well, sometimes that punk era is quite long.
I found that very amusing.
Yeah, he's good. He can speak for hours on this subject, and it's amazing. But women have more to lose than men. Men want to play and women want to get serious. That's the whole thing. So when men grow up a little bit later, generally, it depends on their family like that. Sometimes if they have a good family, they grow up nicely. They can avoid the punk era. Like that. That's why nowadays we have so many ladies who are not married. Why? Because they see, you know, the problems with getting married and this broken relationships. There's so many divorces. So the women are more cautious now getting married. And therefore, you know, they go on sometimes too long without getting married. And then that's a problem too. Therefore, parental supervision really helps. That's why it says a woman should work under the care of her parents until she gets married. Of course, in Western society, parents are not so educated either. But in Vedic culture, parents who are of that culture and training, you know, that's their responsibility. If a father's main duty in the family is to get his daughter married, if he doesn't do that, he's negligent in his duty. That's a serious oversight. That's his main duty. And when he finds a husband for his daughter, he worships that husband as if he would worship a deity. Says that the father pays respects to the son-in-law and honors the son-in-law because he's helped him, what we say, take care of his main responsibility, finding him a husband for his daughter. The father is completely grateful. That's Vedic culture, which is real culture like that. So now times the fathers don't take enough responsibility for the daughters. They should be very actively looking for their daughters, making sure they find a nice husband. Yes, I think we got off the guru thing.
Yeah, I had a question about the guru topic.
Bring it back to, because I said this is in a whole nother subject. It's a very sensitive subject too. Yes.
For a grihastha topic, 1 weekend will not be sufficient, Maharaj.
1 year would
it will not be. You were talking about in the context of a material disqualification or a material imperfection, in a guru does not disqualify him. So I was thinking that a material perfection. In the name, so-called perfection, may not necessarily be a qualification either.
Yeah.
For being a guru.
Exactly.
So sometimes, and then you expressed that sometimes people choose a guru because of some material way of seeing things.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a question that comes up quite often. When a person says, ah, such and such is my guru, and if a question is, how did you know, is some answer like, my hairs were standing on end in that class, or somehow I felt very ecstatic when something happened.
So your question is, how do you really know?
How to know?
Well, we discussed this. And what the answer we usually come up with is that, of course, the search principle should be there sufficiently. One should search out a spiritual master for a long time until they actually, you know, are sure. But what you're looking for in that person is that person that you have developed complete faith that that person can take you back to Godhead. In other words, many persons can inspire us in different ways, and maybe many persons can inspire us in the same way, but that person who consistently inspires us to serve and to surrender, that's the guru. Not just he gives a nice class and our hairs are standing on end and we're doing backflips in the kirtan. No, that's not the whole. That person who you feel can take you back to Godhead and who can encourage you to serve and surrender. You want to give your life to that person. So that's what you should look for. But nowadays, you know, we pick personalities, you know. Women usually choose gurus because, you know, something they see as a husband. You know, it's like, you know, if I had a husband, he would be like my guru. Something like that. Not all the time. But it's like that. It's a problem sometimes. You know, so therefore, guidance in choosing a guru in order to discriminate what is one's motivation for surrender. Why do you want that person? Well, he's cool. He dances nicely. He talks nicely. He got a lot of money. We speak the same language. Right? Same culture like that. Yeah. These are all external. They're all, and sometimes they're detrimental to the actual mood of surrender.
From Mandar Peshwe Prabhu.
Who?
I'm not sure who that is. Mandar Peshwe?
Speak slower.
Mandar.
Mandara.
Peshwe.
Okay. Mandara.
His question is, can there be ups and downs in spiritual master-disciple relationship due to unsteadiness in devotional service? How to move forward?
Well, there shouldn't be ups and downs. One should know. I mean, nowadays, what we're doing is we're having educational seminars on how to practice, you know, being a disciple. So learn what it means to be a disciple, and there won't be any ups and downs. I mean, it'll just be in one direction. And the spiritual master also must be qualified to lead his disciple like that. So now we're also having seminars. There's one coming up in February on, you know, guru. What does it mean to be a guru? So we want to avoid any future, you know, fall downs from gurus. So what do they have to do? Or what do they need to do to, you know, be more proficient, sufficient, expert in their service? So if everyone knows their service nicely, even if there's an up and down, it'll be just very small. It won't be a continuous up and down like that. Up and down means there's no real communication. You see, we do have a certain dynamic in this society because of the way it's structured, is that the guru is not in the same place as the disciple, sometimes. You know, most of our spiritual masters travel, and therefore they're not always with the disciples. But you see, in the Vedic cultures, the guru was there, and the disciple, they were in the same villages and same areas like that. You can always contact your spiritual master. Now it's email, but email is really insufficient and somewhat impersonal. And I talked to one senior devotee, and if someone writes them a problem letter, he says, I don't answer it on email. I simply arrange for a phone call. And then I deal with it. Because email, you can't really, you say something, they say something back, you say something. So it goes on, and then there's no real conclusion like that. So, therefore, when you get the opportunity for personal association, hey, grab it. Take it much as you can. Take it in the right mood. To learn, to hear, to serve. And you'll find, now you get all your questions answered. And if they're not, then just whatever's left, just ask. So we should avoid ups and downs by proper relationship. Yeah. Mark, you're next after Chaitanya Nitai.
This is kind of in relation to the question Nityananda Prabhu was making. What should you do if you you find someone that's that constant inspiration for you, but they're not actually an initiating spiritual master, but that's the person that you, in your heart, feel is your spiritual master.
That's happened before in ISKCON. And I've noticed that some people are actually waiting for that person to get, you know, in that position. I can name a few, but I won't. So, yeah. So, but you can still take guidance from that person. And that person can be your spiritual master, but still, to get connected to the parampara, diksha is still required. So get a diksha guru, but before, when you get a diksha guru, you should, say that, actually, I'm really inspired by this person. I really want to take instructions and guidance from them, and if he gives approval, then wonderful. And usually they give approval. There's nothing more pleasing to a spiritual master than when his disciples is getting help from somebody else. It's really pleasing. Because, in our society, it's required. It's required. If a person's not getting a help from anyone outside of their spiritual master, they're going to really, really struggle. And that's why we have the mentor system. I don't know if we can talk about that briefly, is that now it's required that everyone has a big brother or big sister in their area, aside from their guru, that they are accountable to. So they can get guidance and ask questions and whatever. That system is being developed in many places. Because how does a spiritual master know what's going on in your life? Just what you tell him. Well, actually, Mark has a question, and then after Mark, Nanda. Give Mark the microphone.
Okay, thank you, Maharaj. Today in the purport, Prabhupada brought up the verse, Acharya Mam Vijaniyam Navaman Yeta Kardi Chit, from the 11th canto.
Right.
It seemed like when he was analyzing that verse, there was no distinction between the word Acharya and spiritual master and guru.
Yeah.
But yesterday when we were talking about it, it seemed like there was a distinction when we were talking about Prabhupada versus...
This is really hard to sort this out, but... Spiritual master means one who guides one on the path of spiritual. Acharya means one who does that too, but he's also, what we say, teaches by example. Prabhupada used that definition. Acharya means one who teaches by example, one who's proficient to teach by example. So that's the only distinction I know. And sometimes, we say big, big acharyas. It seems like there's a certain emphasis on the acharya as opposed to a spiritual master. He has more caliber or weight within the function, but not within the spiritual acumen. That's what it seems like. It seems like it's a more functional thing. So, but I'm not clear on that. That's just basically my understanding. So, sure, please.
In this case, Brihaspati is called Amara Acharya, and in Bhagavad Gita chapter 13, in those texts where Krishna gives the 20 qualities of knowledge, or items of knowledge, there is Acharya Upasana,
right?
And Prabhupada does translate that as spiritual master.
Mm-hmm.
So in general, it seems that if a more generic term to use, if Acharya would mean teacher, that from anyone who we are learning about spiritual life, Krishna says Acharya Mam Vijaniyam, in that sense that it is that medium through which a person comes to know me as Krishna.
Mm-hmm.
And that you shouldn't see as different, or one should respect equally as. So the word teacher sometimes helps me make that.
As Acharya.
As Acharya. Because here is the teacher for the devas.
Mm-hmm. So that's a good point. And the principle of a teacher. Keep asking that question to different senior devotees and see what kind of answers you get. Yeah. Ananda?
I have a question about the Sri Guru Vandana prayer.
Uh-huh.
10 years back, we got a new edition of Vaishnava song book, and their translation is quite different. For example, first line goes, the spiritual master, the lotus feet of the spiritual master is the best way to obtain Krishna's mercy, and goes on like that, many different. And Dravida Prabhu, he pointed out those differences to us, and he was just wondering when we're going to adopt that.
It was done by Dravida?
Right.
He did the changes?
Well, he pointed out those changes to
us. He approved of the changes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we were just wondering how we are to. Yeah, or when we are to adopt a new, more accurate translation of the song.
Well, when the Bhagavad Gita was, you know, redone according to what was said as Prabhupada's intentions in the translations, were not what was actually written down. I spoke with Jayadvaita Maharaj, and he says, if you know the essence, it's not so much the wording that is so important, but it's the essence. Even when Prabhupada would quote a verse, when he would quote, not the Sanskrit has to be exact. When he would quote the translation, he would quote the essence of the meaning of it, what he was trying to, the verse was saying, and not so much verbatim the actual words. So the idea is to get the understanding of what it actually means.
Like many religious,
you know, words have connotations, you know, but then there's the denotative and the connotative. The denotative is, you know, the exact meaning, and the connotative of what's in spiritual life. We use connotations a lot. You know, what is the idea that's being transmitted through these words?
Like in Christianity, they say that Jesus is the only way, and then we also say the lotus feet of the spiritual master is the only way. So,
yeah. But they're wrong also. It's right. Then, when they say Jesus is the only way, and we say the lotus feet of the spiritual master is the only way, we're saying the same thing, because what we're saying is Jesus is in the role of the spiritual teacher, is saying that there's no other way to the Supreme except through the spiritual teacher. That's the only way.
Right. But actually, it's the best way according to new translation. It's the best way. That's how it's translated now.
Well, there obviously you have to ask the question, well, what other ways are there? Are there other ways to the Supreme? Obviously there are, but not completely. There are other ways that take you closer to the Supreme, but not the spiritual master is the best way, because he takes you all the way. You can get it. You can get it through other persons who can also teach you and guide you, who are not in the role of a spiritual master. So, this is something that needs to be discussed. Okay, Himanshu, and then...
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Two online questions. The first one is from Maria. Mataji wants to know, Maharaj, we are to reveal our heart and mind to purify the self. If one finds it hard to do, how does one overcome this? And are there topics to avoid?
Or to reveal our mind and heart to purify ourselves. Well, you have to be careful how to do that. It's not just dumping garbage, you know. It's revealing your mind in a certain way. Do you present it in such a way that you pose a question that you need to have answered in relationship to what's concerned in your mind like that? So there's a way to reveal your mind, not just revealing your mind. And revealing your mind needs to be done in accordance with an individual who can assist. In other words, and that person has to have certain qualifications. One, they're trustworthy. Two, they're competent. Three, they can help you. So, yeah, what the purification is you're getting rid of the blocks in your spiritual life and you're able to move forward. That's where the purification will come, not simply by revealing the mind, but acting on what you get once you reveal your mind. There's where the purification comes.
The other question is from Carlos. He wants to know, is there a method or a way to reprogram a person when we get a spiritual master in terms of etiquette and manners?
Reprogram who?
The disciple. In terms of his etiquette and manners when he gets a spiritual master. So is there a way to do that?
The whole process is a reprogramming affair, right? Is there anybody here who hasn't been reprogrammed yet? It's an ongoing thing. So reprogramming, no, over this way. Prabhu there. Yeah. Reprogramming, you're chanting Hare Krishna, you're getting reprogrammed. You're reading the books, you're getting reprogrammed. You're eating prasadam, you're getting reprogrammed. You're associating with devotees, you're getting your programs changing. All these things are purifications, which are reprogrammizations. That's what's happening. You're getting purified. You can call it reprogramming or purification. Right? If you want to just be the same person, but, you know, be different in the way you express your sameness, that's not reprogramming. I want to be a better materialist. That's not reprogramming. That's just turning up, you know, the same channel. Change the channel. Okay, so, yes. Haribo. How are you? How's your health?
It's fine.
You're okay now?
Yeah.
Recovered?
Yeah.
Amazing. Hi. Prayers of the Vaishnavas.
In our movement, we see so many devotees are taking 2-3 times, you know, initiation. So there's a failure. So still you think about some behalf of Prabhupada taking some another guru, or you direct think about Prabhupada as a spiritual master?
Yeah. Once you get initiated, and even if your spiritual master falls down, you're still initiated. And you just take shelter of Prabhupada and take shelter of the association of devotees in the process. You don't need another guru. But in some cases, people are so weak in their own spiritual life, they have to have somebody. So we are allowing reinitiation, but it's not necessary. There's no scripture injunction that says you need reinitiation. You're already initiated. As long as the spiritual master was in good standing when you took initiation, which is usually the case. So, and then, you know, so yeah, you're already connected. You just follow the process, take association with devotees, like that. No. But if you're not strong enough and you need another spiritual master, that option is available. In fact, that was a debate in ISKCON for a long time, that we shouldn't allow reinitiations. That was coming from certain devotees, but that was rejected because certain devotees really, they can't make it unless they have a living spiritual master. So reinitiation was given. It's not against the injunction, but the injunction doesn't say you have to get reinitiation. So yeah, you're right. Just take shelter of Prabhupada and follow the process. And you're already initiated. Did that answer your question? Yeah. Thank you.
Maharaj, I'm a little worried about this part, so I'm asking this question. Why does the spiritual master have to suffer?
He doesn't suffer. So anybody in Krishna consciousness doesn't suffer. Suffering is for the karmis, for the materialists. Devotees have difficulties. There's a difference between having difficulty and suffering. And so there's inconveniences, there's difficulties, there's reverses. Very well. But suffering is for the non-devotees. They suffer. Suffering, it comes with attachment. When you're attached, you suffer. If you're attached to Krishna, you never suffer. You might have to go through some inconveniences. Bhakti Tirtha Swami, he was a beautiful example of a person who was apparently undergoing some real severe physical pain. But, you know, he turned it into an opportunity to preach Krishna consciousness. And even though he was experiencing tremendous pain, when he was hearing, you know, Chaitanya Charitamrita read to him, he was saying, I wouldn't trade this position for anybody, he was saying. So the material body is going to go through what it has to go through. You can expect it. Well, you know, people say, oh, he's sick, he's dying. Yeah. Welcome to the material world. This is the way it works, man. Get it? You're going to be in the same position too, so don't be surprised. This is reality. Mm-hmm. Don't try to hide reality behind some false illusion. It's just the way it is. The only way you can get out of this mess is become Krishna conscious, and then you can transcend all these things. Otherwise, the body goes, disease is there, haribo. It's just the way life is, right? You plan for, you know, we know what our philosophy is. Hope for the best, expect the worst. That keeps you going in Krishna consciousness. Hope for the best, expect the worst. That's what I said to Dayita when I came. The first day, when the room was cold, there was no bedding and nothing, and there was nothing. I said, he was apologizing. I said, no, I'm just used to it. I just hope for the best and expect the worst. Sorry. Just so you don't do it again. So the point is, yeah, that's the way life is. You hope for the best, expect the worst. If you expect the worst, you're never disappointed. But still, you should hope for the best.
Maharaj, my question actually was, at the time of initiation, the spiritual master takes away the karma, and then again...
They just don't make any more problems, that's all.
Okay.
That's all. Don't worry about that. Just don't give him more headaches, that's all.
Yes, Maharaj.
Okay. Haribol. Are we running out of time? It's 9:20 now. Okay, so we'll take one more question from our Igor, who's running the mic. Is this an online question?
Yes, Maharaj.
Okay. Is there any questions here first before we take online questions? I always like to give priority to the to this place first. Yeah. Okay. Arka, and then we'll take the online question and that's it.
Maharaj, you mentioned yesterday that obedience creates faith. And I was wondering, what are some ways to increase one's obedience to Guru and then increase our faith in the process and the Guru and...
Ask him what you can do.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you. Good. Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. This is a question by Mandar Pishwe.
Mm-hmm.
His question is, with fall downs that happen in GBC and also in the past history of ISKCON, how can one have implicit faith to regard Guru on an absolute level as Sri Krishna?
Obviously, these things shake people's faith. We're not going to try to say it doesn't. It does shake people's faith. Therefore, we, you know, there shouldn't be any fall downs. We're trying to prevent that. But in the history of spiritual life, these things do happen. Then you have to somehow or other go on without your faith being destroyed. Obviously, your faith is going to be shaken. It's obvious. So, therefore, it's up to the society to try to do whatever they can to prevent that. That means give the protection to the devotees so they don't fall down. It's like, fall down sometimes are due to isolation or not proper association. There's one panacea if you're having problems. If you're having problems, just associate with devotees, especially senior devotees. And don't try to do anything. Just be in the association. Just try to hear, try to serve. If you do that, you'll find your faith grows again. So we're not going to say that these things are okay. They're not okay. And every time someone does fall down, it really shakes the whole society. And it gives our critics more fuel for their criticisms. And they just step up their criticisms when these things happen. So we want to create more and more atmosphere where these things can be prevented. And so there's no excuse except that these things do happen. But go on. Don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Mm-hmm. In other words, just because a guru falls down doesn't mean all gurus are bad. Okay. But when it does happen to you, then go and get shelter and talk and get your mind cleared so doesn't, you know, turn into some kind of loss of faith, you know, extreme loss of faith. Get some shelter. Well, every time that happens, you see the GBC runs to the disciples to give them solace and, you know, shelter as soon as that happens. So, like that. Okay, thank you. So next session is at 11 o'clock. And then tonight we'll speak on the prayer, Sri Guru Vandanam. 11:30, yeah. No, I just was thinking of yesterday's schedule. I forgot it was 11:30. Yeah, 11:30 is better. Okay, so 11:30, 1 o'clock. Thank you. Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Yeah.
to announce what help you need for what?
Hare Krishna, after breakfast, we're going to be cutting vegetables for the Sunday feast. So anyone who's available, please come downstairs. After breakfast. After breakfast, we have vegetable cut up downstairs. Please come. Hare Krishna.